Hello everyone. Today we start with our topic laser therapy. This topic of lecture series have two parts. So let us start with part one. In first part we see introduction, history, properties of laser, then classification and production, how the laser beam produced for the therapeutic purpose, and in end we will see the types. So let us start with introduction about laser. So laser is an acronym for light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. It is electromagnetic wave amplifier which can produce pencil like beam with special properties. So due to this special property, the laser light is differ from the ordinary light, that we will also learn afterwards. Therapeutic laser is also known as soft laser, cold laser, low intensity laser, or class 3AB laser or optic laser. Laser is a beam of light which is used for various purposes. It can be used in military, it can be used in different light shows, it can be used in making CD players, then it is also used in medical purposes also. The great example is the laser light show at Akshardham at Gandhinagar, if you remember. And in the medical purpose, it can be used in dermatology field. If you remember or you may heard about laser process is done for removal of the unwanted hairs, permanently removal of the unwanted hair from the body, and it can be used in ophthalmology field for the repair of the retina, mainly in the diabetic retinopathy patient, and it is also used in various surgical field for the making surgical incision. If we see the history of laser, it is not so old. In 1917, Einstein has given or has outlined the principles of underlying the production of laser radiation as a part of quantum theory, as the production of laser is based on quantum theory. So in 1960, Dr. Theodore Meyerman has invented a first ruby laser in USA. Later on, the Bell worker of the Bell laboratory has invented helium neon laser, and afterward they have invented carbon dioxide laser, which is more popular in surgical field. Then in 1979, the semiconductor diode laser has been invented, which is mainly used for the therapeutic purpose, and it's a type of gallium arsenide laser. Now, properties of laser light. Because of this properties, laser light is completely differ from ordinary light. So let us understand one by one of properties. First is monochromaticity. Laser light have property of monochromaticity. If you see this word, then you may have idea that monochromaticity word is a conjunction of two words, mono and chromaticity. Mono means single, chromaticity means coloration. So laser light have a single color light, or you can say it has a single wavelength. So it has definite frequency. While if we talk about ordinary light, then there is many wavelength and many frequencies. So it has different color. So first property of laser is monochromaticity, means single color, single wavelength and definite frequency.
So
another property of laser is coherence. Coherence means similar behavior. As we know, laser light have similar wavelength, same way they are coherent in nature, means the photons behave in a similar manner. If we imagine the waveform figure, then there is a crest and tuft. So the photons crest meets another crest same time and in same direction. So when we are talking about or when we are talking in reference with time, it is known as temporal coherence, and when we are talking in reference with direction, then it is spatial coherence. So this is the important property of laser, which is not present in ordinary light. As we know, ordinary light have different wavelength, so they are not in coherence. So there is a cancellation and reinforcement of the light. So if this factor minimizes the power of ordinary light as an energy source. But here, because of coherence and monochromaticity of laser light, we can deliver very less amount of laser energy to a small area of part for very less time period to gain desired effect. Now, another property is collimation. Laser beam remains collimated, that means they remain in parallel and they do not diverge much, and the energy can be propagated over larger distance. This collimation occurs due to the spatial coherence. Okay, so you can say the collimation is a consequence of the spatial coherence. So in figure you can see the difference between ordinary light and laser light. In ordinary light there are many wavelengths, it is multidirectional and incoherent, while laser light is monochromatic in nature, directional means collimated and coherent. So there is very good example to better understanding of laser light property, which is given in low end read. Just imagine one group of military people and one normal crowd of people, then you have idea what is difference between ordinary light and laser light. If you the ordinary visible radiation is like a crowd of people all in direction, different clothing, walking in a different direction and out of step, while laser radiation is like a column of soldiers all marching in a same step, means same phase, in the same direction and wearing the same uniform, means monochromatic. Okay, so this is very good example to understand. Now, classification of laser mainly classified into hot and cold laser. Hot laser are high intensity laser. They are mainly used in surgeries and that causes tissue heating, and generally power is more than 60 milliwatt. While cold laser are low intensity laser, mainly used for the therapeutic purpose, and there is no tissue heating occurs with this type of laser, and the power is generally less than 60 milliwatt. So here is a detailed classification of the laser. Mainly there are class 1, class 2, class 3A, 3B and 4 and 5. From class 1 to 3B are known as low intensity laser, or you can say cold laser, while 4 and 5 are hot laser or high intensity laser and mainly used for surgeries. Generally class 1 and 2 are used for the laser pointer, and if you know in the mall there is a barcode reader which is class 1 type of laser, and in OPDs we are mainly used laser is of class 3A and 3B. Now, production of laser, how laser light can be produced. So, on the principle on which the production of laser light is based is quantum theory. To understand this production, first we recall the structure of the atom. As we know that there is an electron of an individual atom remains as a cloud of negative charged around positive nucleus. So that is also we have done in our school physics, that there is an atom and if you remember the structure of atom, there is a negatively charged electron around positively charged nucleus, right? So according to the quantum theory, this electron in the periphery of the nucleus have tendency to receive or absorb some energy level. So under normal circumstances, the majority of atoms, the electrons remain at the lowest energy level, that is at the resting or a ground state. If enough or sufficient energy is added to atom, the outer electron may gain sufficient energy to free itself from the nucleus. So this outer electron receives the energy because according to quantum theory, this electron have tendency to absorb the energy. So if energy is given to the atom, the electron which is situated outer side will receive the energy, and that have tendency to gain this energy and become at a higher energy level, and atom then becomes a positively charged ion and electron becomes a free negative charge. When the outer electron are in one of the higher energy state, they will tend to return to a lower energy state and sometimes to more stable or a ground state. So again this electron tries to gain a stable state or a ground state. So at that time this electron of active atom undergoes a stimulated quantum jump from higher energy level to lower energy level, and at that time they causes the emission of photons, and these emitted photons collide with other excited electrons and they causes more photon emission, and this chain reaction produces the laser light. So you can say process of light emission occurs at a three stage. First, the electron of atom absorbs the energy from the energy source, then it goes from lower energy level to higher energy level, and then they tries to come down at the ground level again. So when they tries to take a ground level, they spontaneously emitted a photon, and this emitted photon again stimulate the another emission of photons, so that is stimulated emission. So this chain cycle creates the production of laser light. Okay, so if we summarize the production, this occurs in a three process. First is absorption, then spontaneous emission, and third is stimulated emission. So here is the lasing action diagram. In this diagram, you can see the baseline which shows the ground state of electron of atom. As we know, in normal circumstances, the electron of atom remain in a ground state or a lower energy state. Whenever sufficient energy is given to the atom, this electron receives the energy or absorbs the energy and take excited state. From excited state, they again try to take a lower energy level, and for that they do quantum jump from higher energy state to lower energy state, and they spontaneous emit the photons. Again, this emitted photons collide with other excited electrons, and they causes more photon emission, and this chain reaction produces the laser light. Okay, so hope this diagram will further enhance your understanding. The component of laser production, which are common in all type of laser, and they are listed here. First is lasing medium, second is energy source, and third is resonating chamber. So these all component are present in all type of laser, which we will talk later about the type. So this laser device must consist all these three component. Let us understand all these three in detail. Lasing medium, the name itself suggests, lasing medium means the material which produces the laser radiation. Whenever the energy is given to the lasing medium, this medium produces the laser light by give of the photons. So this may be of solid crystal or semiconductor or liquid or gas, depends on the type of laser. Suppose in ruby laser, the lasing medium used is ruby crystal. In helium neon laser, the helium neon gas is used as a lasing medium. And in diode laser, the aluminium gallium arsenide used as a lasing medium. Okay, now energy source always a flash gun is used to excite the electron of the lasing medium. The source of flash gun is usually current electricity. Third one is resonating chamber. The resonating chamber contains the lasing medium, which is surrounded by two parallel mirrors at the either ends. One of the mirror has 100% reflectance, while the other has slightly less reflectance. So the mirror with slightly less reflectance serves as an output device, which allows some of the photons to escape through it. Okay. So this is about component for the laser production. So here is a figure. In that you can see the laser component. Here I have shown you the active medium, or you can say laser medium. Then excitation mechanism, or you can say energy source. And the resonator chamber, which is made up of active medium, and at the both hand you can see the high reflectant mirror, and on right side there is a partial reflectant mirror which serves as the output of the beam. So from this figure you are more clear with the component of laser. Now different types of laser, mainly there are three types: ruby laser, helium neon laser, gallium aluminium arsenide laser, and carbon dioxide laser. The ruby laser is also known as solid laser or crystal laser. Helium neon is gas laser, and gallium aluminium arsenide laser is diode or semiconductor laser, and carbon dioxide laser, which is mainly used for surgical purpose. And here in chart you can see the wavelength in nanometer of a particular laser type, and which radiation they emit. It is also mentioned in the chart. Ruby laser emit the red light, helium neon laser also emit the red light, the diode laser emit red to infrared radiation, and carbon dioxide laser also emit the infrared radiation. Now let us do types of laser in detail. So first start with helium neon laser. Generally in OPD we are more deal with helium neon and diode laser. So first we discuss the helium neon laser. So this three components are common in all the three types of laser. So first, in helium neon laser, the lasing medium used is helium neon gas. Helium neon gas in this type of laser is situated in the glass tube with low pressure, and at the both end of glass tube contains the 100% reflectant mirror, and at another end there is a partially reflectant mirror which gives ultimately the output of the laser beam. So, and here the energy source is flash gun, and that flash gun is become excited by the current electricity. So whenever we are giving current electricity, the flash gun gives energy to the lasing medium, and here the helium neon gas, the electron of the helium neon gas receives or absorbs the energy from the energy source, and they take a excitatory state, and again they try to take a metastable phase. So at that time they emit the photon. So that is called spontaneous emission of photon. So whenever they do energy jump from higher energy to lower energy, or you can say when they do quantum jump from higher energy to lower energy, they emit the photon, and again this term is known as spontaneous emission of photon. This spontaneously emitted photons, again they will stimulate the another active electron, so they may lead to further emission of photons, and this cascade is continuously occur, and the production of laser light occurs, right? So at that time we have we have a red light radiation, and we get a laser beam of red light with wavelength of 632.8 nanometer with helium neon laser. Okay. So here is the figure of helium neon gas laser. So this is the circuit how the helium neon gas laser works. So in the figure you can see there is a glass tube which is filled with helium neon gas, and at the ends of the glass tube there is a high reflector mirror and a partially reflector mirror which gives ultimately output of the laser, and here the flash tube is going to give energy by help of current electricity. So the circuit is seen in the figure. Another type is ruby laser, or you can say crystal laser or solid laser, because here the lasing medium used is ruby crystal, which is synthetically made by a combination or a mixture of aluminium oxide and chromium. Almost 1 cm thick and 10 cm long ruby rod is used, which is silvered at the both end by at one end there is a 100%
silvering of the road, and at another end there is partially reflectant silver is applied over another end, and which makes a resonating chamber. And here the energy source is xenon tube. Here the xenon tube is wound around the ruby rod. Whenever the current electricity is applied, the xenon tube creates a white flashlight, and this energy is given to the ruby rod, and electron from the ruby rod absorb the energy. Again they take a unstable higher level energy state. At that stage they tries to take a lower energy level, and at that time they emit photons. This is again called as spontaneous emission, and again this photon again stimulate the other active electrons, and this way the whole chain occurs and we get photons of red light and of having a wavelength of 694.3 nanometer. Now third type of laser is gallium aluminium arsenide laser. It is also known as diode or semiconductor laser. Here the lasing medium is gallium aluminium arsenide, and it is having a semiconductive material, and it produces the laser beam of 630 to 1550 nanometer wavelength of laser. The wavelength of the radiation depends on the proportion of gallium and aluminium. So by varying this ratio we can produce desired wavelength of laser by this type of laser. And another advantage of this laser is that this can emit either pulsed or continuous output. So generally in clinics helium neon and this diode laser are commonly used. So hope you are clear with this part, and I have taken reference from Lowenried and Jagmohan, the book of electrotherapy. So again, thank you all.